Okay, welcome back. I hope you had a nice lunchtime. And we continue here with our next speaker. And we welcome here Bernhard Schütt from BIC, business director there with many years of experience in the market data industry. Today he is supported by Elisa Steiger. She's an implementation engineer at BIC, and today they will present us from unrelated data to well-considered decisions. The stage is yours.
Thank you very much. Okay, good afternoon, everybody. Thanks for being here. Well, what we will tell you today is first of all a short introduction about BIC, about the BIC Market Data Platform. And then we will dive into the ESG data management challenges we are seeing at our customers very often. And then we will present a case study, or Elisa will present this case study, and finalize with some possible questions from the audience. First, a little bit about BIC. BIC is a provider of market data management as a solution and as a service. This basically means that we are providing market data management in the cloud only. And next to delivering a platform, we also have these managed services, and we will have some examples later on. Our product is called the BIC Market Data Platform, and in essence, this is a data vendor independent solution for retrieving, for managing, and for consolidating market data. So we do this for banks, for asset managers, and for insurance companies primarily. And well, as you all know, probably the market data industry is really a niche market. And not so many people around with the wisdom about the market data, about data licensing, about financial markets, the technology. It's quite scarce, you could say. And we always see the same faces during these kind of events. So that also says something, I think. Well, to talk a little bit more about challenges within the market in general, there are three main ones, we would say. First of all, compliance and control. So over the last few years, well, data has grown tremendously, and the regular market data, but also especially ESG data. It's coming from new laws and regulations, for instance, and it's really hard to get grip on the data and to consolidate and centralize all this data needs into one system, basically. And secondly, there are very limited change resources available. One of our bigger customers recently said to us that they spent around 95% of their time, development time, on compliance. So there's very, very limited time left to change anything in your market data infrastructure or to innovate. And then finally, already mentioned it, there's not so much knowledge about market data out there. So there's scarcity, and in the end, it could lead to a picture like this. So this is what we call the market data spaghetti. And what you are seeing right here at the left-hand side are the data vendors, we all know. But it could also be your internal data. It could be third-party data from asset managers, for instance. And there are a couple of things happening here. So first of all, we are seeing all these interfaces flowing to databases or to departments. It could also be a direct connection towards a downstream system or application. And first of all, it's quite hard to maintain this spaghetti, both at the left-hand side, because feeds are changing all the time, of course, but also at the right-hand side. We also know these examples that, let's say, Department A is unaware of the fact that Department B is procuring the same data, but they don't know it from each other, or they are requesting the same data at one of the data vendors, but they don't know it from each other. So that's not very cost-efficient. And then the final problem with this, especially at the right-hand side, is what we call technological vendor lock-in. So these downstream systems are maybe very bound to a RIC code or a Bloomberg ID or maybe other type of identifiers. And it's really hard to change this if you would like to use other data vendors or if you would like to switch. Luckily, we are here for you with BIC. So we really believe in a fair marketplace for the market data industry. And what we mean with this, we want to provide our customers flexibility and choosing the data vendors they really want to use. But this also means a very transparent pricing model. And what we are seeing in the market, in the market data industry, is that pricing is not that transparent. We try to do that very differently. Well, we provide market data management as a solution and a service, and the BIC Market Data Platform is our product. And, well, what is, I think, very important to mention here as well, we are not that big of a company. We try to work together with customers very closely. We think that's critical in having success. But our customers also rely on a pragmatic approach. And like I already mentioned, our transparent way of working, but also the pricing, which is very transparent. Basically, we specify up to the minute how much time we spend on a customer. We specify, well, our salaries, and we specify the margins we take into account, so there are no nasty surprises for our customers. I think that's quite unique in the market data world. That being said, this is the big market data platform. So what you are seeing right here, again at the left-hand side, you have all these data vendors, and our customers are having the contracts with these data vendors. So BIC is purely a technical facilitator. We are not a redistributor of data. So a couple of things are happening here. First of all the data from the left-hand side is being stored in the Silver Copy database. And within the Silver Copy database, we need to make sure that all the data is being validated. So validation could be very technical in terms of, okay, is it a feed format like we expect? Can we parse the data into our database, yes or no, etc. But it could also be on data quality aspects, like completeness of the data, actuality of the data. It can also be very business specific. When things are going wrong during validation, as part of our managed services, we go back to the vendor to solve the issue at the source. It's not mandatory, it's optional in that regard, but it's a service we provide. And when data is valid, we can import the data into the Golden Copy database. And what we do here, we consolidate all the data to one common data model. So an easy example would be that, let's say, a Morningstar is sending over a net asset value. LSEC Libre is sending over an NAV. Basically, we are talking about the same data field then. So we put it on one record in the database and we have multiple providers delivering the same data. So we consolidate all the data into one data model. When this is done, we have to apply authorization. What this means basically is to take a very careful look at the left-hand side to the contracts you are having with the vendors, to check out the limitations in using the data or certain restrictions in using the data. We need to make sure that this is all adopted into the entitlement layer we have. And then finally, we apply record linking, or in other words, mapping. So we map together exchanges, we map together certain currencies, we can also map together identifier codes, like connecting a RIC code to a Bloomberg ID or to connect it with internal instrument identifiers. And by doing so, we can offer the data in the API. It's basically set up in, well, what we call GraphQL technology. And within GraphQL, you are able to construct your own queries. So these are just some examples of types of API calls you can do on the BIC Market Data platform. But in the end, you're completely free to do it yourself, to construct your own queries. And then in an ideal world, you would be able to connect this consolidated API to your downstream systems and applications at the right-hand side. And, well, the big benefit of mapping all the data and consolidating all the data is that we now have the opportunity to switch data vendors easily. So if you are today using Bloomberg for certain data, you would like to go to LSEC or whatever vendor, then it's just a matter of changing the authorizations. And there's no need to change the interface because the consolidated API of BIC won't change. You are using the BIC data model and not the data model of the data vendor. So that's quite important. We also know these examples that certain, let's say financial institutions have some old legacy systems in place, which could not be able to handle JSON output from an API. And because of this, we also have a configuration tool on top of the API in which we are able to specify certain output formats. So we are able to mimic existing interfaces, basically. So if you need your data in a CSV format and you need it to be pushed on an FTP server and maybe you need your own naming conventions, then we are able to configure this for you as part of the managed service, but you can also do it yourself. And by doing so, we are able to connect this market data platform very easily to an existing market data landscape. Because the big problem always was that there is no change capacity at the right-hand side. You don't want to change your systems to connect to this platform, and therefore we made it very easy. Some final words about this slide before we head over to the ESG topic. We do some other things as well, like calculations, ESG screening, the topic for today, statistics about using the usage of the data. And this is all part of the managed services. And then finally, all elements from the blue dotted line to the left are hosted in our cloud environment. So we provide SLAs, we provide the support, the maintenance, and continuous development of the platform. That being said, if we zoom in on ESG data management, there are also quite some challenges out there. And, well, to summarize it a bit, first of all, there are many diverse data sources out there with different data formats. There's a lack of standardization. It's really hard to compare those kind of data sets. Then secondly, compliance and regulatory reporting, it's changing quite often. We are now thinking and talking about new SFDR technical standards. Then you have to adopt quite quickly. So that's a big one. Next to that, integration, to consolidate all the data together in one model, but also accessibility of the data, who can get to the data in essence. Data quality, of course. We are seeing many problems with completeness of data, but also with integrity of the data itself. And there are not so many tools who can help you to scrub this kind of data and to clean it and to check for quality. And then finally, operational efficiency and cost management. It's expensive data, it's expensive in terms of operations to handle this kind of data. And then it's also quite challenging to scale up if you would like to do so, or if you would like to change vendors, for instance. And then finally, the volume and velocity of the data. It's much. We are handling around 5,000 attributes regarding ESG data right now. It's growing very rapidly, and you have to pace up if you want to keep a track of developments. I'm going to give it over to Elise to tell you a little bit more about our case study for ESG screening.
Yeah, thank you. So as Bernard already said, I'm going to show you how we assisted one of our customers in the implementation of the ESG screening project. And I will do this by first showing you the initial stage of how this customer implemented the ESG screening project. So in this first step, this customer used a lot of internal and external data sources. So for example, this customer used ET data, but also ESG risk data and aggregated holdings. Besides those external data sources, this customer also used a lot of different internal data sources, like request files. And with a lot of different data sources, there are also a lot of different formats, symbology, and delivery mechanisms. So a lot of variety in the data here. Then we were confronted with a lot of different processes and venues to scrub, store, or cleanse the data. And the thing we've noticed here was that data that was, for example, processed by this application was also processed by this application, which means that there's a duplicate in data. The other thing that we've noticed here was that the data that they used a lot of different manual processes. So for example, to combine data from this database with the results from this application. And as you can see in this picture really represents the problem that Bernard talked about, because this also really looks like a spaghetti mess. Then all the data, so all data from different processes, but also all data from different data sources with different formats, are all dumped in one single CSV file. So this becomes really chaotic. Also, the ESG screening rules are applied on this file, and this is mainly a manual process. The results of those screening rules are distributed to different data sets, which are then utilized by different downstream systems, endpoints, or domains. And all of this theoretically works. However, there are a lot of single point failures. So as you can see, a very small problem here affects a lot of people here. Think about data unavailability, mapping errors, or data licensing mistakes. So having this such an unstructured implementation, because of this unstructured implementation, there is our increased risk of errors, but also delays in decision-making and high costs because of the data duplicates.
And I think this is a familiar problem for a lot of people. So now that we've witnessed this chaotic implementation, let's move on to the solution, because this solution aims to untangle this spaghetti mess. So how did we do this? How did we help this customer? We started by retrieving all required data. So again, the exclusion list, ESG risk data, or ESG ratings. Then we structure all of this data. And we do this by consolidating and unifying it. So all data from different sources with different formats, symbologies, all conform to a consistent structure. And this also involves segregating the data per provider and separately handle it as a feed. This is also the place where the mapping is performed. This is done to combine data from different sources, but also to use your own naming conventions or your own internal identifiers. And finally, the ESG screening classification on instruments, issuers, or objects is assigned with a pass or with a no pass, where pass means that it is compliant with the ESG screening rules. And no pass means it's not compliant, so it should be excluded from, for example, portfolio. To name an example, this customer wanted to exclude companies that invested for a certain percentage in tobacco. And this customer also used this screening solution as a pre-screening solution to screen third parties on ESG policy. So you can see that we've managed to transform the chaotic implementation into a well-structured platform where the customer is now also able to combine data from different data sources, but also to switch from vendor without having to switch the whole platform and use own naming conventions or identifiers. And as we implemented this ESG screening project at this customer, we discovered several factors that contributed to making it a real success. Those factors are starting with validation. Validation is really important, not only to meet the high data quality standards, but also to ensure compliance and accuracy. Secondly, centralization is also important. So centralization of the business logic, which is moved away from applications and is generalized across the whole organization. And also centralization of the ESG screening rules, which are based on binary values, thresholds, but also ratings or controversies. Integration also plays a crucial part here, because you want to use the outcomes of the ESG screener to limit non-conforming instruments, to update your exclusion list, or to screen your universe on unwanted changes. Consolidation is really important because this is the part where data from different sources is normalized and you can get the data and really only the data you really need. Mapping, as previously already discussed, is also crucial because you want to combine data from different sources, you want to switch from vendor, and you want to use your own identifiers. Finally, unifying of the data, which means rescaling data values and unit types to one single truth. And of this last one and the consolidation, I have an example. So we see that there are three different vendors here. They all have different data fields. So one uses carbon emission, and the other uses carbon dioxide. I hope I pronounced it correctly. And they are all normalized into the same big data field. This is the consolidation of the data. Unifying is also represented here. As you can see, those different vendors have different vendor unit types. One uses metric tons, the other pounds. And they are rescaled into one single big unit type, kilograms. And this example then also represents what Bernard talked about, the vendor lock-in, because you can see that when you switch vendor, you do not have to change the whole platform. And you can easily combine data from different vendors because you have the same big data field and big unit type. So give it over to you. Yep.
Thank you very much. Well, to sum it all up, the biggest benefits we bring to our customers with this ESG screening solution, first of all, is to centralize all the loose data sources. As we saw, to untangle all the market data spaghetti, the ESG data spaghetti, into a consolidated data model, which is comprehensible for everybody. Secondly, to adapt ESG screening rules easily, we have a GUI, of course, to make these kind of business rules and to edit, to edit it, to delete rules. So, well, you can vouch for changing policies, for instance. And then finally, well, by using this platform, you govern your ESG data in the same way you would govern your regular market data. So in a centralized way. And by doing so, ensuring continuity in the process. Our last slide for today. So we would like to end with the promise we make to our customers and to the industry. First of all, we really believe that the implementation of a cloud-based market data platform is feasible with little time efforts. It could feel as a big bang project. However, by having this consolidated feed and by having these standard or specific output formats, we're able to mimic existing interfaces and to replace as is very easily without big IT impact. Secondly, we really feel, again, that your solution provider, be it big, be it another one, should feel as a pragmatic colleague. So our customers like Rabobank or like Dekabank, they will say about BIC that we are their external colleagues from the Netherlands, helping them with market data and ESG data challenges. And then finally, again, you may expect full transparency in terms of pricing, in terms of the way we communicate with customers, and, well, no nasty surprises at all. That brings me to the last slide. If you would like to know more about this solution, we have a demo available. So we can set up a demo. If you would scan this QR code, you will end up at our website. You can download the fact sheet, etc. Of course, we are also here today with a booth at B8, to be exact. So maybe we can have a chat about it. And yeah, that's our story. So are we in time?
Yes. There's still time for questions.
Cool. Yeah, so it... Are there any questions? Yeah.
Yeah, thank you. I would have some. Imagine that ESG data is evolving a lot. Criteria, new criteria come up, or definitions change. How could a bank know that the basic definition has changed, or they could include new factors? How could they adapt their strategy on this basis? And the second question I have is concerning auditing, in German it's Wirtschaftsprüfer.
Lineage? Data lineage, you mean?
No, so then now we have customers where external editors come and review their CSRD or their SFDR documentation, and they ask, what is the basis of this data? How have you calculated? How can you provide this security of data?
Okay.
Thank you.
Shall I answer it? Let me go back a few slides. I think it's this one. To start with your first question, changing needs or changing requirements, basically. I think one of the biggest benefits of BIC is that we are able to add new data feeds very fast. It's not a matter of weeks, it's a matter of hours. When data is changing within a feed, which was maybe unexpected or new data has been added, we will always see during the validation part that things are changing. Maybe we need to take a look at it. Maybe something is going wrong. And we also provide the means of, we call it 4 Eyes principle, to edit data or to enrich data maybe, or to use proxy data when the data is not when the data is absent. And there's a GUI for this. So during the validation, you will see all the gaps in the data. You are able to fill the data gaps if you would like to do so. Somebody else has to take a look at it to agree on the changes you have made. And then third person, so it's a 6i principle, has to publish the changes. And then the data will flow through to the APIs and to your downstream consumers. The other question you asked was about, I think, about the traceability of the data. Step one, all the way to the distribution of the data from the API, all actions are logged within the platform. So we trace how data is being consolidated and normalized, but we also track per attribute who is the data vendor delivering the data. Maybe you have enriched it yourself, then we are also indicating that in the metadata of the ESG. And in the end, also this metadata, this traceability or data lineage kind of data, let's put it like that, is all retrievable by the API as well. And the final thing, we can also make reports about it, about who changed the data, what happened, et cetera, et cetera. So I hope that gives an answer to your questions. Thank you. Any more questions, maybe?
Perhaps one more question. We heard from, I think it was, we report that there are many market data platforms available. What would you say are the key differentiations?
Yeah. Thank you for the question. It's always a nice one. I think the flexibility on the output side. So especially this specific and standard output formats, we are able to connect to whatever system out there. So again, if you have a certain system and it expects an XML file with a certain structure, then it's just a matter of configuring it within the API. So also me as a business guy, I'm able to make my own API queries to configure the output and to put it in a system eventually. And this is, I think, quite unique in the market. So on the distribution side, we really set ourselves apart from competition. On the ingestion side, yeah, we have all the familiar names, I would say. Thank you. Any more questions, maybe? Okay.
And no more questions, Ben. Thank you. And hence what the audience today.
Bye. Thank you.